إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله by the very same people who when they put the head of Imam al-Hussein on the spears they were doing takbir and tahleel because they won a great victory. Those are the times when Al-Imam Zayd was born. Al-Imam Zayd's father was Zayn al-Abidin. And usually a man, as long as the father is alive, may Allah preserve all your fathers, and if you are fathers, may Allah preserve you for your children. It's very important, because the children take from the father. They take these characters from the father. They take these things from the father. They inherit the qualities from the father. Al-Imam Zayn al-Abidin, as you all know, was in the Battle of Karbala. Again, this is all an introduction to get to understand the personality of Zayd ibn Ali. He was in the Battle of Karbala. When his family was massacred one after the other, including the children, etc., the infant, 7, 6 months, Abdullah Radi'. The 6 months, the infant. But he was sick. So he could not leave. Though he took the sword and he tried to leave the tent, but his father, Imam Hussein, look at al-Tabari, Ibn Sa'd, Imam al-Tabari, Ibn Sa'd for al-Tabaqat, Ibn al-Athir in his tarikh, all the references of Ahl al-Sunnah, and read these things because it tells. Remember that those who don't know their histories do not understand their present, nor can they deal with their future. Because history repeats itself simply with different names and different figures. Tyranny still exists. And in the same methods, just different names. Anyway, Imam Zayn al-Abidin could not go and fight because he was sick, and when he tried to leave the tent, his father, Imam Hussein, ordered him to go back. No, al-jihad fard, if you are capable, just like al-hajj, you have to be capable in order for that to be fard upon you. If you are not capable, that's not fard. Yasqut al-fard. Al-Imam Zayn al-Abidin, then after the massacre of Karbala, where the heads were put, the heads of Imam Hussein and all his family were put on the spears. From now we're talking Karbala, which is Nineveh. Nineveh now is that southern area of Iraq. And they took these heads on the spears. They left the bodies fi Karbala. And they put the heads on the spears. And then the rest of the people who were alive, who was alive left? The women and the children, the women and the children who were not killed, they were left alive. Among them, Zayn al-Abidin, who was in his between 18 and 21, roughly, at that time. We're talking year 61 of Hijrah. Left now, put all in al-Jami'ah. Al-Jami'ah is something, it doesn't mean university here. A jami'ah called jami'ah because it puts the one who is tied with it, ties his hands, his head, his feet, and his trunk all together with the mule or with the donkey that it is carrying, that's being carried on. First the heads, then the survivors. Among the survivors are who? The women, all of the women, only Zayn al-Abidin is left, and the women. Among the women, Zaynab bint Ali, Zaynab al-Kubra, with their faces uncovered. And they were walking through the cities. The reason Yazid wants to do this is so he can show people, teach people a lesson, that if you revolt against tyranny, this is what will happen to you, even if you are the son of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. After those who were killed, those who were beheaded, were put on the spears, going from city to another, city to another, all the way through Iraq. After Iraq, they went through northern Syria, and they went, notice, the line went through all the way from Karbala to northern Iraq, through Al-Mosul, which is the province of Nineveh now. Then all the way through the eastern Syrian desert, through the Aleppo, which is the northern Syrian, went down all the way to came to Damascus, Al-Sham. When they reached Damascus, all this convoy takes days. And people are watching, what are these things here? Huh? When they went, by the time they arrived to Damascus, it was time for celebration because, quote unquote, Amir al-Mu'mineen, or the ruler of the state, supposedly Amir al-Mu'mineen, has now gained victory over the Khawarij. This was the propaganda. Those who violate the Sunnah, they don't know anything, and they revolted against the book and the Sunnah, so that's why we had to kill them. They came and people were in celebration. Open up Tabari, you see these things for yourself. These moments of humiliation Imam Zain al-Abidin lived. So much that there's some narration that says when Imam Zain al-Abidin came into Damascus, Sahl ibn Sa'd al-Sa'idi, among the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, Sahl ibn Sa'd sees this convoy and sees people are happy, says, what's going on? People, they say, this is a time where these people who revolted against the Khalifa are captured and they're brought, so they're happy. When he came close, he realized, the Sahabi, he realized that this is Zain al-Abidin Ali ibn al-Husayn. Sayyidina Sahel told Zain al-Abidin, told him, Ya ibn Rasulullah, or son of Rasulullah, what can I do? He says, do you have some, the Imam Zain al-Abidin told him, do you have some money so you can give the soldiers, this way they can put covers on the face of my aunt Zainab and the daughters of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because people are looking at them from every which direction. تناموا بنات يزيد في القصور مقيمة وبنات رسول الله في الفلوات. The daughters of Yazid are living in the palaces, honored, but the daughters of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم are subjugated to humility. This is what we're talking about here. Imam Zain al-Abidin lived these things. When he went back to Al-Madinah, when Yazid sent him back to Al-Madinah, he was of course under embargo. Don't think that Zain al-Abidin simply went back to Medina and he was free. Every now and then, Yazid or Marwan or someone would send them, whoever was the Khalifa in Damascus, would send an order, bring Zain al-Abidin back to Al-Sham. Interrogation, jail, punishment, torture, humiliation, go back to Medina. Until they killed him. And of course, they're not going to stop there, they have to kill him. Through the life of Imam Zain al-Abidin, so we understand how Imam Zaid was raised. Through the life of Imam Zain al-Abidin, three things I'll take here and I will show you, and we will try to take them as keys to enter the personality of Zaid. Number one, sadness. Imam Zain al-Abidin, his life could be characterized in extreme sadness. And Ibn Kathir al-Umawi Dimashqi, the known Sahib al-Tafsir, Ibn Kathir mentions this. He mentions that Imam Zain al-Abidin, was asked, why are you so sad? And you're da'im al-huzn, you cry, all this. They have been killed long time ago. He told them, Ya'qub alayhi salam, he answered, that's all Ibn Kathir is narrating this. Ibn Kathir says that Ya'qub alayhi salam cried for decades until he lost his eye vision over Yusuf, knowing that Yusuf was still alive. And I have seen dozens of my family being slaughtered like sheep in front of me. That was a character of Imam Zain al-Abidin that was very difficult for him, and it consumed him. It consumed him and it consumed his life. The second thing is that made him, of course, along with the other circumstances, to abandon politics. He could not talk about politics. He did not do these things. Not that he did not order the good and forbid the evil. He did. And he said in a known statement by him, At-tariku, the one who does not order the good and forbid the evil, nabidun likitabillahi wara'a dhahri. He's putting the book of Allah behind his back. But he left the political arena for another mission, which is teaching the Ummah. He turned his house into a session of knowledge. Those who could go and would risk going into the house of Zain al-Abidin would go and they acquire knowledge. Then they stopped that from him. They wouldn't let them. People do. If you go, you go to jail. So Imam Zain al-Abidin went to a very smart idea. People were enslaving people back then. So he went and bought slaves. He took the slaves and he put them in his home in the desert. He had a home in the desert out there for 1 year, 1 full year intensive crash course with Zain al-Abidin.